Hi Mirai.
Hello.
Welcome to our series on CSO leaders.
Thank you very much.
Mirai, as I understand, you've graduated from the Harvard University and then you did a master's from Johns Hopkins Bloomberg in public health. So at what stage did you decide that you wanted to be in India and work with the underprivileged? And what was the inspiration?
I remember distinctly the moment that struck me, and that was when I was 14 and I became aware that there is a whole other world out there, a whole other world of fellow citizens, other Indians. And I remember because there was an old man who came to our compound in Mumbai where I lived and where I grew up, and he was singing for a living. And he was old and shuffling about, and I remember thinking at 14 that this is unfair. Mm-hmm. No person in old age should be doing this. I didn't know anything about pension or anything, but somehow it struck me as unjust. So I think that was a sort of aha moment. By the time I was 16 and I went overseas to the United World College of the Atlantic and International School to do my international baccalaureate in those days, this was 1976 or so, I was already quite firmly convinced within that I must return and I must contribute in some way.
So what was your mother's or family, the rest of the family's reaction to this? How were they happy about this? What was their
thinking? Well, my mother, who I must say was widowed very early, and actually she had wanted to go overseas to study. But in those days, it wasn't very usual for young girls or women to go overseas, and she didn't get the chance, even though she got in to colleges overseas. So I think she was very keen to give me that opportunity. And so at 16, I got a scholarship to the Atlantic College in Wales, in South Wales, this international school. And then one thing led to another. The family thought it was a bad mistake.
Of coming back?
Of sending me out of the country in the first place.
I see.
Too dangerous, risky. And then when I came back, they were even more confused because they didn't understand why would someone who went to sort of a fairly prestigious university want to come back and work in the slums of Ahmedabad. Ironically, heard about Seva while I was at Harvard University, because I was, I suppose, searching, looking, finding out, and a friend of mine told me that there are great things happening in your country among women, and she showed me a cutting about Ila Ben and her work. And I was already interested in the women's movement and the labor movement. And so it seemed like it was a natural progression.
How has been the journey, I mean, with Seva? You've now been there for almost 33, 34 years. So what was some of the initial struggles and some of your great hurrah moments, if you could share?
Well, first of all, I was very inspired by Ila Ben. In her quiet way, she said, go finish your studies and we need young women like you to come and join. And so I did. And it was fortuitous, just at the time I finished my public health degree, the members of Seva were demanding health work. They said, we have organized, we have built our union, we've got a line of credit and a safe haven for our savings in our own Seva bank, we're saving. But whatever we're saving goes in big medical bills, goes in doctor's expenses, medicines. Either we are sick or our children are sick. And so they said, we need some kind of preventive health program, some health awareness. And so they said, teach us how to be healthy and so that we can work. And as they put it so beautifully, they said, our bodies are our only assets. As long as our hands and feet work and we have two eyes, we can see, we can work and earn and feed our children. And so, as I said, as a young public health fresh graduate, I got a wonderful opportunity to contribute. And the first day I walked in, I just felt this is the place for me.
Do you see that there is a greater relevance of people with a certain level of educational background or professional background contributing better to the development sector?
Well, I think certainly a professional degree, like in my case, public health, does equip you with some skills and with some knowledge that can be useful to people. But I don't think that education itself or qualifications itself is the main point. In my experience, and I've seen thousands of women who never had the chance, and I've seen them, our SEVA members, never had the chance to go to school. They were too poor, or they were girls, and their brothers only went to school. And yet they are wonderfully intelligent. They have contributed so much to the SEVA movement. So I think each of us has different things to contribute. I would not say it's just the professionals who have something to contribute. I mean, all of us as Indians have something to contribute. We all have talents. So I think education, you know, these days, not trying to belittle the impact of education. Education is extremely important. But I would like to ask the question, education for what? Is it education for critical reflection? Is it education to ask questions of our society? Questions like, why do we have persistent poverty? Just reminding ourselves that Mahatma Gandhiji said that poverty is violence. It's the collective violence of society on its own people. So does our education move us in that direction to question and then take action and contribute to help and support in any way our fellow citizens? Or is it just for ourselves?
Are you finding more and more people who are now looking at taking this as a work option? Do you find more young people wanting to come in?
I think there's a lot of interest, both in young women and men. And now we also have young men who join us, MBAs, to head off and be the managers of some of the enterprises and cooperatives we've created. I do find a lot of interest. I think the culture of SEVA is very different because, as I mentioned earlier, it's a membership-based organization. I think there's some unlearning that we professionals have to do, which is that we don't have all the answers. We have to come in humility with the willingness and openness to learn from others. And if that happens, then it clicks and then the young people stay on. Sometimes it doesn't work for them, and that's also fine. Each of us has to find our path, our journey. But we find a lot of young people. Recently, I have a young woman who joined us from Ambedkar University. She has done the MPhil course in community development, which Pradhan has co-developed. We've had a couple of women and men from that course. I have another young woman who did applied mathematics from Harvard University who's joined us to be the managing director of our cooperative federation. So I think a lot of young people are searching, they understand, they are looking to contribute, and they're looking for direction and some meaning in their lives, just as I was 35 years ago.
Any thoughts or messages for some of the youngsters and young professionals wanting to look at the overall development sector as a place, as a choice of work?
Well, I don't want to be prescriptive, but all I can say from my own experience, it has been a wonderful experience. No regrets, no looking back, because basically you're dealing with human beings and it's extremely rewarding. It's enriching. It's a wonderful opportunity to contribute. And as Ilaben always says, that at the end of the day, we get a good night's sleep, even though there are frustrations and challenges. And yes, the challenges are many, but it's also very intellectually challenging for professionals because you have to come up with solutions, and you have to come up with solutions, not just theoretical solutions, but solutions working with people who have so little and yet themselves have so much rich experience. So they are also challenging you all the time. So it's not just bookish knowledge that works here. It's working shoulder to shoulder. And what better way to spend one's life than work with other human beings?
Thank you very much. It's been really enlightening talking to you.
Oh, that's
and
fine.
Inspirational too. Thank you so much.